From the Library of Congress in Washington, D.C.
My name is Rebecca Newland, and I'm the teacher in residence at the Library of Congress. And I hope you'll excuse me, I'm a little bit giddy today, because I'm here, celebrating books and reading, and it's my birthday. But the real icing is that I have the honor of introducing Rita Williams-Garcia. Some of you are here as fans of One Crazy Summer, which was selected for the 2011 Coretta Scott King Award and the 2011 Scott O'Dell Prize for Historical Fiction, as well as being chosen as a 2011 Newbery Honor Book and 2010 National Book Award finalist. Perhaps you were drawn here to hear about her most recent book, P.S. the 11th. A sequel to One Crazy Summer. You might be here because you love Jumped, a 2009 National Book Award finalist. Possibly you have been wanting to meet a Penn Norma Klein Award for a New Children's Fiction Writer honoree. Maybe you have been following her since her first novel, Blue Tights, published in 1987. And maybe you think, if we ask nicely, she will tell us about Gone Crazy in Alabama, which is due out in April. Whatever else moved you, you are here because Williams-Garcia tells stories that engage us, stories that challenge us, stories that remind us of ourselves, and stories that take us into the lives of people unlike ourselves. I'm most excited to hear about Delphine Gaither and her, who lived in a time and place I have not. However, by reading their story, I was transported to Oakland, California in 1968 and back to Herkimer Street, at a time in their lives when historical events, such as the killing of Bobby Hutton and the election of Shirley Chisholm, bumped up against feelings about their absent mother and their father's new wife. So without any more delay, please welcome Rita Williams-Garcia.
So came together and they formed words. They made song, they jumped, they didn't just lay flat, they danced. And then my sister took over. Now, my sister was older, but she did not talk. She just looked at me, she gave me a book, she shoved it through the penitentiary slats and stood there until I opened it. I opened it because that's what big sister said when she wasn't talking, open that book. And I saw the pictures and the words, and I began to actually know what the words were. So by the time I was two, I could read a little bit. The rest are kind of made up along with the pictures. Thank goodness for those illustrators. So story became alive for me as a very small child. By the time I was in kindergarten, I was writing and making up my own stories. Well, before the actual writing came to storytelling. I don't know if my mother would call it lying, but I would say storytelling. But I had a love of just making it all up. Making it all up, playing with words, putting them together, writing a story. Before you knew it, in kindergarten, I had my own publisher. I was an army rat, and so my publisher was GI, government issue. I had my own copyright page and everything. So it never occurred to me to become a writer. I am an author. Look at these pages and these words, some of them spelled correctly. So, it wasn't until I was about 12 years old that I started to take my career seriously, and I would write 500 words every night, type them up, pay my sister, the same sister that sat over me, pay her a nickel to a quarter to borrow her typewriter that she did not use, and I would type up my stories, type up a query letter, and send them out to send them out to McCall's Magazine, Ladies' Home Journal, Ebony, especially for those articles, Can This Marriage Be Saved? Well, my parents, they kind of kept things lightly around the house, so I thought I knew a little something about marriages going through upheaval. I would type up my stories and send them out. The money to come in. Why are you laughing? This was serious. I was a desperate child. The way that I got my clothing, I'll bet you your mother goes to the store of clothing, right? She buys them. Not Miss Essie. Not eight. Oh, no. My mother went to funerals and would walk up to the family and find out where they lived and would come by to see if they had anything for a 13-year-old. Now, unfortunately back then, 13-year-olds were not dying. It was their 93-year-old mothers. My mother would take their clothing, they would gladly give. My mother would take, she'd bring it home, Rita. You're gonna be looking sharp in junior high school. Come on, Miss Henson, put on this dress. All right, ain't no one gonna have a dress like this. And if you're wondering, yes, she snapped her fingers when she talked. So, I went to one of the worst junior high schools in Queens. We had security on the inside before there was security. We had drop-down cages. And sad to say, but this is true, we had a murder my first year in junior high. And my mother wanted me to walk down those hallowed inner-city cigarette-filled halls wearing something that my grandmother would not wear. So I learned to make up stories about what typing them. I started typing them every night, 500 words. I have a novel. Well, it was like a 4,000-page novel, but I had a novel. I was getting ready to send out to the world, and then I learned, oh, you have to edit these things? All right. Well, fast forward. All of that writing and lying and storytelling and just mimicking people and all that, it all kind of comes together now. Now that I'm writing for young people. And it's been my joy and my pleasure to tell the story of the three sisters from 1968-ish, 9-ish, 7-ish, Delphine, Vanetta, and Fern in One Crazy Summer. When we find them in PSP 11, which is the book that follows them back to New York after they've spent time in Oakland with their estranged mother and the Black Panthers, we get to see them in their own home environment. But you know what happens when you leave a place and then you come back? Things change. Things change. You change. You're suddenly taller than you were when you left. Your father is acting strangely. Why is that? Why is he singing and wearing cologne? He's acting like a teenager. He's our father. What is going on? Everything is changing. Even your relationship with your grandmother, you used to mind her all the time. And now suddenly, I don't know, infused with the spirit of Black power, you try to stand up to Big Mom. You're in the sixth grade, and there will be a dance, and you will be expected to dance with a boy. Hand to swing hand. But they're all shorter than you are. And the only one you will look right dancing with is your teacher. No. But there's one silver lining. There is Michael, Marlon, Jermaine, Tino, and Jackie. And you have discovered them. And now all you have to do is get your father to let you and your sisters go to the concert at our back at Madison Square Garden. So I'm going to just read very quickly a small segment of unpacking the girls and their father, along with Miss Marley Hendricks. Yes, the soon-to-be stepmother. Are going out and the girls make a sighting. We were close to the Brooklyn Bridge when Vanetta cried, "Look!" What, I asked, convinced it was nothing at all. I have been staring off into the blur of Miss Maura Hendricks' curly afro. "Look!" she cried. And then I saw it. We all saw what Vanetta could see from hundreds of feet away. A billboard of Jackie, Jermaine, Tito, Marlon, and Michael sporting big Applejack hats over their even bigger afros. We screamed. The letters on the billboard shouted at us, "The Jackson 5 at Madison Square Garden." And underneath those words, "December." The inside of the Wildcat became a cage of screaming and seat jumping until we finally heard Bob shouting, all right, back there." Miss Lauren Hendricks laughed and laughed. I screamed for Jackie, whose real name was Sidlin, and I screamed for Tito, who had the best eyebrows and always looked cool and tough. And Vanetta screamed for Jermaine, who was kind of good looking. And she screamed for Marlon, who she claimed was the best dancer. The only Jackson Fern screamed for was Michael. every chance we got, we'd stand in the record department of Corvette's store and study every inch of your album cover. Papa, can we go to Madison Square Garden in December, I asked, to see the Jackson 5? We want to see the Jackson 5! We sealed our wishes together, saying, please? The Jackson who? Pa asked. Sounds like a Mississippi chain gang. But Dad asked, what's a chain gang? They make chains, Fern answered, sounding every bit like me. The two got on to arguing about chain gangs when I think Pa intended all along that they would argue. I would let go of our wishes. If we learned anything from our summer with the Black Panthers, we learned to be clear about what we wanted and to be willing to do what was necessary to get it. They are not a prison chain gang. I threw in the prison part to answer Vanetta's question and for solidarity. I need my sisters to be united with me and to go and stay focused. The Jackson 5 is the best singing group in the world. In the universe, Vanetta added. And the Milky Way, Jackson 5, Pa said. Never heard of them. Can't sing any better than Sam Cooke or the Temptations. And what about Smokey Robinson and the Miracles, Miss Henderson said. Oh, and Marvin Gaye. I said, the Jackson 5 are better than all of those singers and groups put together. Your afros are bigger, Vanetta said. And they have Michael, Vernon said. He's better than best. He is not, I said. Jermaine is best, Vanetta said. Jackie is the best looking, I said. And then Tito. Not hardly, Vanetta said. Jermaine is, and Marvin is the best dancer, like I am. And before we knew it, our solidarity had fallen apart. So I will stop.
No.
The young lady up front was asking, where can we find those wonderful books of Rita Williams-Garcia? Because Barnes & Noble is falling down on the job. One of the best things that you all can do, not only for fine books, but for books that you want more of, go up to the managers. Don't just stop at, oh, they don't have them. Ask for them. Bookstores are a business, and so they respond to demand. But you can find my books online, Amazon, or Barnes & Noble. They will actually ship my books. But go to your local bookstores first. Go to your local bookstores. They are in the community. They are trying to tailor their books to meet the needs of people in the community and diverse books for diverse people. So go to them first. Yes, I do. And also, don't forget your public library. It was years before I could really start owning books, but I could own every book in the world just from being in the public library, having that library card. So, and as much as I'd love you to buy my books, but go to the library and find me there too. Thank you.
Yes. First off, I want to say I really have enjoyed both One Crazy Summer and PSV 11.
Yay!
And I was wondering, did you get the inspiration for Delphine Bonnet and for Many Real People, or did you just create them in your mind?
That's a very good question. Did I get the sisters from actual people, or did I just create them? Well, what I had to do, I'll give you one of my secrets. I started with Delphine. Person with a joyless task of having to take care of two bratty little sisters. And so because she was so responsible, that meant the other characters around her would have to be opposite in some ways, in different ways. And so I began to sculpt those characters around her. So I had to make them up because I was never a bratty little sister, no.
I enjoyed reading One Crazy Summer. I actually read it with a number of my colleagues and considered it for our students. One thing that was so wonderful about it is that you bring history that is so important to life for our youngsters, and so we commend you for that. We had lingering was just why, in the choices that you made in creating the mother character, why did you choose to create a mother who's estranged as opposed to perhaps a father or another family figure?
Okay, very, very good question. I think that we're finding a lot of different and so even though maybe 40 years ago it would have been more traditional for the father to be absent, I think today women are leaving households and there's a lot of shared custody arrangements. And so I consciously wanted to do that for today's children who are dealing with an awful lot of that. Thank you.
Yes. What's your favorite character in One Crazy Summer?
My favorite character in One Crazy Summer is Delphine. She reminds me of my big sister. Thank you. Yes.
Where do you get the ideas for your books?
I read a lot. I read a lot of newspapers. I look at people and I collect them. I collect their faces, and their faces always suggest a story to me. And I love history. I read my own diary. Yeah, I got my diary from way back when. Yeah. And it just, you know, everything is open. Everything is open to write about. And so I stay open so I can receive it.
Thank you. I was wondering, I really liked your book One Crazy Summer. It seems to, like, really flow a lot.
something else. I will write, I might step away from that book and I'll work on a different book. Or I'll do something like hit the gym and go boxing or something like that. Or I'll jump rope. But I always try to keep my mind occupied but differently so that when I come back to One Crazy Summer or wherever I'm having a problem, I'm seeing it with fresh eyes. And then I see the thing that has been giving me trouble, because it's very hard to see it when you're like that, when you're very close. So I step away for a little bit. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
And the last lucky winner, yes.
This has been a presentation of the Library of Congress. Visit us at loc.gov.